well, we don't, I, even though this is the church of just in time, I suspect we're seeing most people that are gonna see this morning. So we'll just start with any announcements and or, yeah, announcements for the life of the church and the community. Are there any that we need to share? Quick note that this Wednesday is New Year's Eve, so there's definitely no fitness class that day. Lori said she was ready and willing, but her student said no. Yoga is listed on the back of the bulletin for Thursday. I'm not sure about that. If you're in the yoga class, definitely check in and see if Aunt Rose is going to lead that class. I haven't heard one way or the other. Are there other announcements for the life of the church and the community? Well, this is the chance to stand up because, you know, you've been sitting down a long time already. And say hello to each other, make friends, welcome people that are new to you, introduce yourselves. And wait, you have an announcement, Lori?
I just don't know if everyone was here over there was a 5 o'clock and a 10 o'clock service here at the church, which was, if you can imagine as I speak, the entire place was packed. Every seat was completely, people were like this. They were standing outside. They were up front in folding chairs. They were packed upstairs, but see, point is that it was wonderful. It was very, very, very special, and we had candles and everyone sang, and the children that we have in our church were fantastic, but most of all, that woman up there was amazing. So we want to thank her for all she did during the holidays for all of us.
Thank you. Yes, it was indeed a bonanza Christmas Eve. 75 more people than we've ever seen on Christmas Eve, so a little interesting and crazy and fun. Let's stand up and say hello to each other, please.
Thank you.
Let's rise and sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing. You can find it on page 137 in your red hymnal. Followed by a moment of silence in the Lord's Are there prayers of celebration or concern that you would like to share out loud? Yes, right.
Once again, I'm asking for your prayers for my sister Kate and her husband Bill. Jill's cognition is dramatically decreasing in the last several weeks that she has
For my sister Kate and her brother-in-law Bill, as Bill's cognition changes and Kate is making big decisions about their life and what comes next. And for all those who live with changes in cognition or health, just for transitions for those that we love, those that we hold vigil with, those that we care for, and those that we mourn.
I looked up our friend Steve, who in a couple of weeks is going to go for quadruple bypass surgery, so as he's preparing for that.
For Steve and for his preparations for quadruple bypass, for the skill of those who will perform that procedure, and for recovery and stability and improved health afterwards. And gratitude that such processes exist, they did knowledge, and they can give people back parts of their lives. Kevin.
I love my new job, and my apartment's very nice, and I wish I could have gave everybody a Christmas present, but I was only able to give 4 people a Christmas present, but I was very grateful to celebrate Jesus' birthday, even though it isn't really his birthday on December 24th. Reverend Gail says it's in the spring or summer, and the pastor from Agape says it's in the summer or fall, but I believe it's January 6th. But I might be wrong. But also, if you could pray for my friend Kitty, who only has 1 kidney, and her real name is Alex, and she owns a store, Kitty's Antiques. River and Tamworth visit it because she's very smart, smarter than you can imagine. And so prayer for her, and prayer for Sue, who's having cataract surgery on January 8th, and prayer for my friend Gail. I don't know if she has mono or what, but I work with her at Tamworth Camping Area also. And that's it. Thank you.
So prayers for Kitty and her kidney and her will-being, for Sue and her cataract surgery, and for your friend Gail, and prayers of gratitude for your apartment and your job and your chance to celebrate Christmas and to debate the possible dates of Jesus' birthday. If you want to talk theology, talk to Kevin later. He's got some interesting possible strands going there for you. Other prayers? Yes, Arden.
My New York family is here with us for this week, and it's wonderful to have all of us together. But the oldest daughter is off to Sweden and Denmark and taking 3 weeks. She's in her last year of college, and she's honored to do this and not come up here, but they'll be up to take care of her. So I'm wishing her safe travels, but everybody's just traveling to and from everywhere, maybe, including down the hill.
All right, so gratitude for families and the chance to be with families and good friends. A prayer for safe travels for everybody that has journeyed, is coming or going. May you depart safely, travel safely, arrive safely. And our dad added for people traveling on skis downhill, safe travels. Maybe make a prayer for safe footing, because this is a time of year when people start taking falls. We've already had some on the ice. So maybe all be careful and stable in our footing.
section of the Jewish community in New York that was victimized by a horrible act of violence, knife attack. Prayers for them.
Prayers for the Jewish community in New York. Prayers for their resilience in the face of violence perpetrated again and again to people who are other, right? Sometimes they're Jewish, sometimes they're people of color, of different faith. Someone that we fear and recognize as the other or name as the other. Prayers for those who act out of fear and choose violence. Prayers for those who try to create safety and respond to these situations. And prayers for all of us to hold up all people, not just people that somehow fit into our own tribe, and to know that God is present in every person in this world. And we pray for peace and healing.
Well, I just want to say prayers of gratitude for Sue, Jeanette, Shabbat. I hope I didn't miss anybody that helped during the holiday season. It's very busy musically. I appreciate all the contributions and the time that we have here that made it so special. So prayers of gratitude for all that.
Gratitude for the special music that was offered throughout the season by Jeanette, by Sue, by Bob, by Dominique, by the Osbournes, by the Roberts family, by many different people over the course of the season who have shared their gifts with us. There's a neighbor here in Jackson. His name's Bob, and has been relocated, and he's living with friends over in Maine while they're trying to find more stable housing for him. So prayers for Bob in this time of transition and answers for what may come next for his housing. And I think we've had a couple of significant birthdays here that just passed or are about to happen. So raise your hand if in the last 2 weeks you've had a birthday or you're about to have a birthday. Think that. Oh, Meg, have fun. Arden and Meg, is there anybody back there that might have had a birthday? Oh, yeah, don't try to hold out. Oh, all right. So in the middle of our prayer, we're going to sing Happy Birthday to everybody. So let's start. 1, 2, 3.
Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday.
That are in our community and our chance to celebrate milestones together. For every milestone that causes us to pause, to reflect, and to cherish what we have in this moment. Let us pray. Oh, Holy God, we have named so many people and places that need love, that need justice and healing, that need hope and stability, for simply dignity and comfort through changes in life, and the love and connection to others who will bear witness and be present no matter where the journey may go. We ask for your presence. We say in our call to worship that we have given ourselves to you, and we know that is always a process and that we're always needing to be reminded, but we ask that you will be present to us and that you will help us let you be part of our lives and present to us, and that you will help us when we are able to become that same love and that same light for others in our community and in other parts of the world. Be with and guard those that we love best and give them what they need. Not what we think they need, but what they need. And do the same for us. And hear our gratitude and our celebration for all that is beautiful and good in this world. We need the reminder that there is balance and hope and beauty all around us. Hear now our silence. hear us as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen.
Luke 2:20. Jesus is presented in the temple. When the time came for the purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as is written in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law. Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory to your people of Israel. And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will be pierced with your own soul too. Then also a prophet Anna, the daughter of Phinehas, the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. Then as a widow to the age of 84, she never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem, the return of Nazareth. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth.
Fragrance of cinnamon and fulfillment. The long tapers of cattails are bursting and floating away over the blue shoulders of the ponds, and every pond, no matter what its name is nameless now. Every year, everything I have ever learned in my lifetime leads back to this. The fires and the black river of loss, whose other side is salvation, whose meaning none of us will ever know. To live in this world, you must be able to do three things: to love what is mortal, to hold it against your bones knowing your own life depends on it. And when the time comes to let it go, to let it go.
Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. We've spent this entire Advent season talking about songs. Songs that came out of the scripture and are part of the Nativity story. The voices of men and women who had encounters with Holy Love. And today is the last of those stories. It's one of the rare stories about the childhood of Christ. And it is the song of Simeon and Anna that we hear today. These are two people that have waited faithfully to meet the Messiah. It's an expectation that was growing and urgent in the time of Christ's family. But people believed that that Messiah would show up as one who would overturn political and military and legal authorities. And so the presence of a child as Messiah was unexpected. And it overturned everything. And maybe not everybody was looking in the right direction, coming through the right gate for where the Messiah would show up. But Simeon, who had waited his whole life and was at the end of his life, came to the temple and recognized in that infant, that helpless infant whose parents brought him at the time that Mary was coming to be purified, born into a family that was so poor that they couldn't pay the 5 coins or their ceremony. Instead, they gave the 2 doves. Into this family was born a child who was not all-powerful and almighty. A child that needed the community around him to take care of him, to recognize him and protect him, to raise him up to become the man that he would be, who walked the way that we now follow. Love was born into this world vulnerable, in need of reciprocity and nurturing and care to be seen and named. And one of the people that first recognized him was Simeon, this man who had waited for the Messiah, for the rescue of his people. And it came in a form that would not overturn Rome, not in the ways that we imagine it, but would overturn everyone's expectations and show us a new and a different way, a way of recognizing and sitting down with everyone who was as different as people could be, and giving them voice and volition and belonging in their community. We hear it in Simeon's song because what he says is that this revelation, this love and this redemption is for all people. Those are his words, for all people, not just for the people of Israel, not just for his own tribe, but for everyone. And that this child will walk a way that will open a path of love and connection and belonging for the Gentiles, for everyone who isn't currently recognized within his community. At this child's earliest recognition, a path is already being opened. An expectation is being set out that he will find a way to connect Israel to a larger world, and a larger world to what is nascent hope within Israel. He is also saying, thank you, because he is at the end of his life, and he is ready to let go. But now he can let go of peace because the thing that mattered most to him has come. He has met it, He has met a child and recognized that child and held love in his arms. The hope for his people is there, walking in the world. And so, in peace, he can say goodbye and reflect on his life and give thanks for it. And Anna, who has waited over nine decades for this child to come, she rises up and she's a prophet and she sings out to the people around her the song of redemption. Love is here and there is hope for all of us. And hers is yet another voice that, though we don't know the exact words she says, we know that she was a prophet in her time, a woman who recognized Christ. The voices of all people were so important even in telling this story, weaving it together and creating the protections and the recognitions that allowed him to grow up and become the person that he would be, who we then learn from, whose songs we then sing and teach to our children. How right that close to the end of the year, this is the carol that we hear. It is a carol of peace, of asking, what in our lives do we need to make peace with? What do we need to come into our lives? What do we need to turn our eyes to and recognize and hold in our arms just long enough to find ourselves at peace so that we may let go, either metaphorically of things that are hurting us and harming us and holding us back, or sometimes because our bodies and our minds take us on a journey and we are mortal. Sometimes it is that letting go of one part of our lives and opening ourselves to what comes next, whatever it may be. Simeon asks that question for us and sings a song for us about finding peace and letting go and loving your life. And Anna reminds us of the joy of embracing life, of celebrating every moment, and using your voice to help others, and your hands to help others. Every song that was sung this season was a song of justice, a visualization of the world as it could be, of hope and gratitude, and anticipation for what love can do in the world. We have all loved people that we have had to say goodbye to. Some of them live long and storied lives, and sometimes they die too soon and too young, or in the wrong circumstances. And yet their songs, their lives are songs, and they become part of our song. And from them, we find the light and the love that keeps us lit and helps us continue to be songs for other people when they need that same hope and that same resilience. This season is a gift of song and music. It is a season of gratitude, but it's also a season of reflection, of letting go where you are able to let go and creating space for what you should welcome, that you may come to that place of peace and connection. That is one of your gifts as the children of God. Freely the songs are ringing and singing to us. So let us think as Mary Oliver told us. To live in this world, you must be able to do three things. To love what is mortal, to hold it against your bones, knowing your own life depends on it. And when the time comes to let it go, to let it go. This is the song of the year's end. This is the song of peace and hope. May we recognize that this song belongs to all of God's children, not just to our tribe, but to all tribes. And it is ours to sing out to all people. Thanks be to God. Please rise for Psalm 141, the first to fill out. Verses 1, 3, and 5.
Thank you.
courage to hold on when we need to hold on, and the strength to let go when we need to let go. We ask that you to help us to let these gifts, like the gifts of our lives, be open to you and release into your keeping, to let ourselves go into your love and become part of your love in this greater world. Thanks be to God. And since you're, if you're standing, we're going to sing Joy to the World, 134, followed by the benediction. And then there are yummy goodies in the parish house if you want to eat. Or you can meet me at the bell and ring the bell.